Well, if you need a Bible this morning, please raise your hand. These men would love to put one in your hands. We are going to be in Joshua this morning and chapter 9. Joshua, the 9th chapter. Well, it's great that we're here in January. And as Steve said, we didn't get the weather that they said we were going to get, and that was great. It was wonderful to be able to just come to the house of the Lord. I'm reminded that it's football season and that there's a big football game tonight. I think some people are big fans. I did come across something that troubled me, however. I was reading this article about a first grade teacher who explained to her class that she was a Cowboys fan. She asked her students to raise their hands if they were Cowboys fans too. And so to impress the teacher, all the students launched their hands into the air. That is, however, one exception, a girl named Lucy didn't go along with the crowd, and her teacher asked her why she's decided to be different. And she said, because she's a Philadelphia Eagles fan. Yes. Then what are you? The teacher scolded her. She said, well, I'm that Philadelphia Eagles fan. And the teacher was very perturbed now with her, and her face got slightly red. And she asked Lucy why she's an Eagles fan. She said simply, well, my mother and my father are both Philadelphia Eagles fans. Well, the teacher now got really hot under the collar, and she said, that's no reason, she said. What if your mom was a moron and your dad was a moron? What would you be then? Lucy paused for a second, and then she smiled. So I'd be a Cowboys fan. I obviously have no skin in that game. Joshua chapter 9. If you'd take your Bibles and turn with me there. We are going to be talking this morning about what I've entitled the Gibeonite deception. And I just want to give you a little bit of background as to what brings us to this point. But first I'd like to read the first couple of verses. It says, now it came about when all the kings who were beyond the Jordan, in the hill country, in the lowland, and on the coast of the great sea toward Lebanon, the Hittite, Amorite, Canaanite, Perizzite, Hivite, and the Jebusite, when they heard of it, that they gathered themselves together with one accord to fight with Joshua and with Israel. Let's ask the Lord to bless this passage this morning, shall we? Father in heaven, we thank you for the preciousness of the word of God. We thank you, Father, that your word is true and your word speaks to our hearts today. I pray, Father, that now as we open your word, that you would indeed speak to our hearts. And I pray, Lord, this morning, that as we contemplate the richness of this Old Testament passage, that there would be relevant truth for us today to apply to our lives, things right here and now that we can take away from this passage this morning. Bless your word, I pray now, in Christ's name, amen. One of the first questions as you look at what I just read was it. What is it? They heard, the Bible says, of it. Now you have a little bit of a map here behind me, and the map is going to give you, and you saw this last week, a little bit of an idea of where the people of Israel have come. They came up through here. Do you remember the names of the two kings that the people of Israel conquered? Those ginormous people. Do you remember their names? Sion, and what's the other one? Og, that's right. Well, they came up through that area there and crossed over the Jordan River. That was a great miracle. They crossed over the Jordan River and they came to Jericho. Jericho is an enormously fortified city, and there was a question as to how the people of God were going to be able to gain victory over Jericho. But you know what the miracle entailed. It was amazing the work that God did there in Jericho, was it not? And all the people finally got around that city that seventh time, everything comes crashing down, and the victory was theirs. How many people died taking the city of Jericho?
Zero.
How many people died drowned crossing the Jordan River?
Zero.
If you drowned crossing the Jordan River, you were going to be in trouble because there was no water there, right? Up until this time, everything's been going along really, really well, and then they come to a little town called Ai. Do you remember Ai? chapter 8. We looked at Ai last time. They came up here, and just to the east of Bethel is Ai. And then the strangest thing happened. The people of Israel sent 3,000 troops up the hill to Ai to take that 12,000-person city. And what happened? Well, we know that there now was sin in the camp of Israel. Achan had taken some of the things of that belonged to God that were prohibited under the ban back when they took Jericho, and he buried them under his tent. And because of that sin, God withdrew his strength and power, and we find that what ends up happening is defeat occurs, and there are three dozen men, who are running down that hill country back to Gilgal, who were killed. They go up a second time after the people have reconsecrated their hearts to the Lord and the sin is gone, and they were able to gain victory. And how many people died in chapter 8 taking Ai the right way? None. Zero. And so what's happening is all these victories have been taking place. All of these miracles are occurring. And the Bible says it's there in verse 1 and 2 where we have all of these ites, the Canaanite, Perizzite, Hivite, Amorite, so forth. They all heard about it, the Bible says. They heard of all of these great victories. And so the people of the land decided that they needed to do something. We can't just wait here for these Israelites to come, or our walls will fall down, or they'll somehow suck us out, and next thing you know, we're dead. And so they devised a plan, and the strategy was to put all of these people from the lowland to the coastland to the mountains. Let's bring them all together. Let's bring all the ites together. And all of these ites were going to have a full frontal attack upon the people of Israel. They were going to run down the hill now to Gilgal, and they were going to sweep them off back into the Jordan River and finally be rid of the people of Israel. There's this one little town, actually a cluster of a few towns, and they're known as these Gibeonites. And the Gibeonites thought to themselves, this is not a good idea. We're gonna die. And they thought to themselves, what can we possibly do to escape the judgment of God and the impending victory of the Israelites? Now notice what they do. We're introduced to them here in verse 3. For the Bible says, when the inhabitants of Gibeon heard what Joshua had done to Jericho and to Ai, they also acted craftily. When it says craftily, it doesn't mean they got popsicle sticks out and made something. You understand? And they're going to act deceitfully. And the Bible says they decided to act in such a crafty manner. They set out as envoys and took worn-out sacks on their donkeys, wineskins that were worn out, torn and mended, worn-out and patched sandals on their feet, and worn-out clothes on themselves, and the bread of their provision was dry and became crumbled. And they went to Joshua, to the camp of Gilgal, and said to him and to the men of Israel, "We've come from a far country. Now therefore make a covenant with us." The men of Israel said to the Hivites, "Perhaps you are living within our land. How then shall we make a covenant with you?" But they said to Joshua, "We are your servants." And Joshua said to them, "Who are you and where do you come from?" Well, the Bible, as the writer here of chapter 9 gives us the indication, he actually tips his hand a bit, and he describes that the Gibeonites were actually, in reality, Hivites. Hivites were mentioned earlier in this chapter, and these were people who were forming a coalition to come and bring war upon the people of Israel. The Hivites were actually a nation that had descended from the son of Ham, son of Noah, going way back into roots there in Genesis. It's fascinating when you look at this word for in the Hebrew for Hittite or Hivite rather. It's interesting that some of the post-biblical Jewish commentators have that Hebrew word for Hivites traced to a Chaldean word meaning serpent. What do you think of when you think of the serpent? Well, you immediately flash back to Genesis and you think of the situation with Adam and Eve and you think of the serpent who acted craftily. And no, he wasn't dealing with popsicle sticks either. He was trying to deceive them, and that's exactly what Satan was able to do. Well, they're coming, and they're seeking to deceive the people of Israel. Say, well, that's horrible. I can't believe they do that. Stop and put yourself in their situation. What are you going to do? What are you going to do? You've got this amazing force, and you have this amazing God. And you're sitting there thinking to yourself, we're not going to be victorious, and so the best thing we can possibly do is to go and make a covenant now with these people. And so the deception begins. They begin to pretend to be ambassadors from this far away country. They weren't known to be from Gibeon. Gibeon is actually a place, and there's a cluster of these cities, these Gibeonite cities, but Gibeon itself is about 5 to 10 miles northwest of Jerusalem. So in reality, they really didn't come that far. They made it look like they were coming from a long distance. It's interesting, but the writer here, as he's writing the Hebrew, writes and he uses two different verbs. And this is just, you can put it in your back of your head for some point, I suppose. But when they said to the people of Israel, we have come from a far country in verse 6, the verbiage in the Hebrew actually gives you the idea that they were actually coming to Joshua and to Israel, and that was their final destination, that they'd come as far as they were going to come, and they had arrived. When you come to verse 8, and Joshua speaks to them, he says, who are you and where do you come from? The verbiage is different, and the action is actually progressive. In other words, Joshua was saying to them, who are you, where'd you come from, and where are you going? In other words, you just must have stopped here on your way somewhere else. But the people had come intentionally seeking to make a covenant with the people of Israel. And so they mixed together the truth and they mixed together the lies. Well, what would you do if you were Joshua? What would you do if all of a sudden you were presented with this? Well, one of the things that we find as we compare some of the Old Testament scriptures is there's a lot to this story that's going on. There are a lot of things in the background. And I take your attention, and I'm going to just pop it up here on the screen, but it's from the book of, let me go back to Exodus chapter 34 and verse 12. People of Israel are actually warned. God actually warns them in the law that they need to be careful. He says, watch yourself that you make no covenant with the inhabitants of the land in which you're going, or it will become a snare in your midst. And so the people of Israel were warned to be very, very careful about making any type of a deal with some of these people groups who were supposed to be eradicated from the land. That's an important point to remember. What speaks to me here is the knowledge and the homework that's been done by these Gibeonites. It's amazing how familiar they seem to be with the Old Testament law. You see, they were looking very carefully at a way. How do I deal with this? How can we go from being on the endangered species list to being able to coexist with these people? We don't want to die. And so they must have given some attention back into the law and looked at this and said to themselves, well, look, they're not supposed to make a covenant with people who are living here. And so what we need to do is we need to fake that we're from far away so we can cut a deal. Pretty brilliant on their part, isn't it? That's what you do when you seek to be able to survive. I find it interesting as well, just a little side note here, in Deuteronomy chapter 20, if you want to flip back 10 or so pages, Deuteronomy chapter 20 in verse 10, when it's giving some of the rules of warfare back in Deuteronomy 20, it says, when you approach a city to fight against it, you'll offer it terms of peace. If it agrees to make peace with you and opens to you, then all the people who are found in it shall become your forced labor and shall serve you. Now keep that in mind as we stop and we think about this that's happening here in Joshua chapter 9. Well, what ends up happening as we continue to read this this account, they said that the servants have come from a far, very far country because of the fame of the Lord your God. And this kind of gives you a backdrop to some of the fears and some of the concerns that the Gibeonites had. They acknowledge the fact that Jehovah is the God of Israel. You see that there in verse 9. And then they go on to say, we've heard the report of him and all that he did in Egypt and all that he did to the two kings of the Amorites who are beyond the Jordan, Sihon and Og. So he says, so all our elders and all the inhabitants of our country spoke to us, saying, take provisions in your hand for the journey and go to meet them and say to them, we're your servants now, then make a covenant with us. Well, fascinating way of doing it. Have you noticed what they left out on purpose? They go back to recount what happened far, far away down there in Egypt. And then they mention what happened with the kings over on the Transjordan side and the fact that, you know, they've done all of these amazing things. What they don't mention is Jericho and Ai. I think they were thinking to themselves, let's pretend to be ignorant about those two cities being conquered so that we can cut this deal with them. And so everything looks really, really good. Then they pull the bread out. Notice this. Take provisions, they were told. And so he says, this is our bread. It was warm when we took it for our provisions out of our houses on the day we left to come to you. But behold, now it's dry. It's become crumbled. You see, the people of Israel, the leaders, verse 14, so the men of Israel took some of their provisions. They took some of the provisions. That is, they sampled some of them. Must have been something like this. And here's all these crumbs. That's not too bad. I tell you, it was warm when it came out of the oven when we left. It was such a long time ago. But here it is. It's just all these crumbs. And the people of Israel came over and said, let me see those crumbs. And they looked at the crumbs and went, okay, all right. And they believed them. That they had actually journeyed, this is pretty good, they actually journeyed all that long way. And I love illustrations that you can eat. You know what I'm saying? I love those gingerbread houses that the kids used to make. And I used to always try to eat those things like in February. And my wife would say, you know how much dust is on that? And it's been sitting out there and it's hard as a rock. But anyway, it's edible. So is gum if it's protected when it falls. Anyway. Hope there's no children in the audience. People of Israel came and they talk about this food. And so the leaders looked at it and they were totally convinced. Now what they've done is they've looked at the evidence. They no doubt are looking at these men. They're covered with dust, no doubt. Their shoes, their sandals are worn out. And the wineskins that they have are patched and mended and they're old. And I mean, all this stuff is really, really lining up. And the Bible tells us here that ultimately the deception is a success. But later here in verse 14, we don't want to miss this because this is epic. The Bible condemns the fact that they did not, the people, the leaders of Israel, they did not ask for the counsel of the Lord. Do you see that there in verse 14? They did not ask for the counsel of the Lord. And because of that, they were in trouble. Now, I want you to go back with me to Numbers chapter 27 and see something here. For the Bible is going to tell us here, starting there in verse 15, where it says, then Moses spoke to the Lord, saying, may the Lord, the God of the spirit of all flesh, appoint a man over the congregation who will go out and come in before them, who will lead them out and bring them in, so that the congregation of the Lord will not be like sheep which have no shepherd. So the Lord said to Moses, take Joshua the son of Nun, a man whom is the spirit, in whom the spirit is dwelling, and lay your hand on him and have him stand before Eleazar the priest and before all the congregation and commission him in their sight. You will put some of your authority on him in order that all the congregation of the sons of Israel may obey him. Moreover, he shall stand before Eleazar the priest, who shall inquire for him by the judgment of the Urim before the Lord. and at his command they shall go out, at his command they shall come in, both he and the sons of Israel with him, even all the congregation. And Moses did certainly as God had commanded. So going all the way back to the books of the law, once again, we read there very carefully, it's written out that God would back with authority Joshua. But what Joshua needed to remember was that he was not to walk by sight, but rather to walk by faith and the direction that God was giving. You see, when they looked at all the empirical evidence, they came up with the realization that, yeah, these guys must have come a long way. And oh, that bread is really crusty, and maybe it's moldy by now, too. They must be as they are saying they are. But the problem was that Joshua was doing the same thing he did over in Ai, which was to walk by sight. Joshua is a tremendous, tremendous man of God. God has called him out to be courageous, to have faith. He's singled out for his faith. He is obedient to God. He is the man who I am dying to meet. He is a wonderful man of God. But we're reminded that there is no man of God who is perfect, is there? And his one flaw that I can see so far in our study of the book of Joshua is the fact that he tends to do what we often do, and that is to appeal to our own strengths and awarenesses and forget about the inquiry of the Lord. He rushes up the hill, not him personally, but he gives direction. Remember the 3,000 that ran up to Ai? They scoped it out and they came back and they said, Joshua, this is nothing. These guys are nothing. We just ripped down the walls of Jericho. How about it? Just go on up there with 3,000 men. Let's get the job done. And Joshua said, go for it. And they come running down from the mountain. You know, three dozen have died. Where was the inquiry of the Lord then? Where is the inquiry of the Lord now? Joshua is specifically told to inquire of the Lord and get his direction from the Lord so that the congregation will follow not Joshua, but the words of God. You see, that's what's at stake here. And what Joshua is looking at is all the earthly evidence, and he's not making that right decision. You and I tend to do the same thing, so let's not be too hard on Joshua. He said, Lord, I got this. I got it. I know exactly what to say. I know exactly what to do. I know how to respond. I know. Where's our inquiry of the Lord, you see? I can make this decision. Have you prayed about it? Prayed about it. Now, the interesting thing here with Joshua is Joshua has not committed a violation of the scriptures other than, well, he needs to do that. He hasn't committed one of the breakings of the Ten Commandments. But the omission here is glaring, isn't it? It's glaring. You and I need to acknowledge who God is and operate within the sphere of understanding who God is. We need to come to God for wisdom and direction, do we not? We need to pray about the things that are so necessary and seek the wisdom of the Lord at the crossroads of our lives. I remember back when I was working with single adults, people would come to me and say, Kevin, you know, I understand I need to be praying about these things, that, you know, but I went to buy toothpaste at the store and I just bought Colgate and didn't pray about it. You know, maybe I should have prayed about it. I'm like, no, you know, it's okay, you know, and you get into all that whole permissive will of God and all that kind of stuff, and you start talking about that. Here's the reality. There are so many decisions that we make that have very significant impacts on our lives. We need to make sure that we're going to God. We don't need to go to God for what kind of gum to buy or what kind of deodorant to wear. But the spiritual decisions need to be made after coming to God. And what I like about this passage of scripture that I find encouraging is that after this happens, the people of Israel, the leaders of Israel, didn't make the same mistake twice. Notice with me here that it only takes 3 days before all of this deception gets found out. Notice verse 16. Came about at the end of 3 days after that they had made a covenant with them, that they heard that they were neighbors, and they were living within their land. And the sons of Israel set out and came to the cities, their cities, on the third day. And it lists their cities. The sons of Israel did not strike them because the leaders of the congregation had sworn to them by the Lord, the God of Israel, and the whole congregation grumbled against the leaders. But the leader said to the congregation, "We have sworn to them by the Lord, the God of Israel, and now cannot touch them. This we will do to them, even let them live, so that the wrath will not be upon us for the oath which we swore to them." The leader said to them, "Let them live." So they became hewers of wood, drawers of water for the whole congregation, just as the leaders had spoken about. Joshua makes peace with them, and then they discover, wait a minute, this is not at all the right thing to have been done. And the people of Israel, the congregation, is now up in arms against the leadership. And the leadership here is pressed with a decision to make. What do we do with these Gibeonites? We've made a mistake. We entered into an agreement with them. We should have never done that. But now doesn't it make good sense to kill them? Let's just kill them, and then the problem's solved. But Joshua says, no, we can't do that, because that would make things even far worse. I remember a golf pro saying, one of the things you have to deal with when you're playing golf and you make a bad shot is to work on your mental aspects so that you don't make two in a row. I thought to myself, that's very true, but I don't set out to make one in a row. It just happens. Then there's two in a row, and there's three in a row, and four in a row, and then you're eating lunch. People of Israel were fooled. The leaders were fooled. And they made the wrong decision, but they didn't make another wrong decision on top of the decision that they'd made. You with me? In Psalm chapter 15 and verse 4, it says, "But he honors those who fear the Lord." And then it says this, "He who swears to his own hurt," that is, he who takes a vow to his own detriment and does not change. In other words, this is something you and I wouldn't understand because it's different in our culture. But in their culture, when you made a vow, you made sure you kept that vow. It was of great significance. You remember Lot back in Sodom and Gomorrah, and he's trying to honor and do those things. There were certain cultural aspects that were always to be upheld. Take your Bibles and go with me to 2 Samuel, if you would, chapter 21. In 2 Samuel chapter 21, we're reminded of a situation that involves the Gibeonites of all people. Saul's on a rampage, and he is taking the lives of those in Israel. He is kind of off the hook with things, and we're introduced to what's going on in verse 1, where it says, "There was a famine in the days of David that lasted 3 years, year after year." So it's 3 years in a row. That's what he's trying to make the point of. "And David sought the presence of the Lord." Now, that's the right thing to have done. And Joshua, listen. Kevin, listen. Right? "Seek the presence of the Lord." And the Bible says, "The Lord says, it is for Saul and his bloody house." It's for all the killings that Saul's been doing. That's why we're into 3 years of famine. "And King David calls the Gibeonites and spoke to them." The Gibeonites are not of the sons of Israel, the Bible says, but of the remnant of the Amorites. Remember some of those terms. Amorites was a blanket term. Sometimes Canaanites can be used that way. And here in Samuel, you see it as a blanket term for these that included the Hivites. "And the sons of Israel made a covenant with them. But Saul had sought to kill them in his zeal for the sons of Israel and Judah." You'll notice it's not for the zeal of God, it's for the zeal of the sons of Israel. So David said to the Gibeonites, "What should I do?" And what they came up with was for restitution, he says in verse 6, let seven men from his sons be given to us, and we'll hang them before the Lord in Gibeah of Saul, the chosen of the Lord. And the king said, I will give them. Now, interestingly here, the people, these Gibeonites, at this point in time, 2 Samuel, have assimilated well into the Jewish culture. In fact, so much so that I noticed the language that's there in that last part that I was reading when he says, and we'll hang them before the Lord. Interestingly enough, these Gibeonites have assimilated well into the household of Israel. So much so, even in Nehemiah, when Nehemiah's back and he's doing the rebuilding, who's there with him helping him out but the Gibeonites? Interesting. These were people who you thought would have no place. These were people who had a great deal of pride, but they were willing to submit themselves to the people of Israel in order to be able to live. Go back to Joshua chapter 9, and I'll just look across the page. Because across the page in chapter 10, it tells us a little bit about these Gibeonites. It says, Gibeon was a great city, like one of the royal cities. I'm in chapter 10, Joshua, there in verse 3. And he says, because it was greater than Ai, and all its men were mighty. These mighty men, these warriors, these victorious men had come and now would be willing to draw water and cut wood. And Joshua would say to them, this is your lot, this is what you're going to do, because we have made this covenant with you. He says here that they would be drawers of water for the congregation, verse 27, and for the altar of the Lord to this day, in the place where he being God, would choose. Now, what I find fascinating as I look at this is Joshua here in the midst of this big conflict. You say, well, what exactly is this conflict, Pastor Kevin? The conflict itself is the fact that we have these deceivers from Gibeon who are standing there, and they know that they are flat out guilty. They've been caught. They've been found out there in verse 16. And the congregation of Israel wants them dead. And so they call for their heads. Who intervenes but Joshua, who says no, but instead they'll be servants of the Lord. That's fascinating how that all has worked out. Because I look at it and I see a type of Christ here in Joshua. For you and I as sinners have come into this world, and all of us, the Bible teaches, are sinners by nature. In fact, the Bible is so clear, it says there's none righteous, no, not even one. All of humanity has received a sin nature, and we stand under the condemnation because we are guilty of a holy God. You see, the congregation of the people of Israel were calling for justice, and perhaps rightfully so. But Joshua, who acknowledges this vow before God and the covenant that is made, steps in between. You and I have a problem, and the problem is our sin. We stand under that condemnation before a holy God, and the one who has come between the holiness of God and the sinfulness of man is none other than the person of Jesus the Christ. For he has come to seek and to save that which was lost, and that is all of us. Jesus is our mediator. He is the go-between. And if we place our faith in him, the Bible teaches that we will have a full pardon from our sin. Is that wonderful news? You bet it is. And Joshua steps in and protects, along with the other leaders of Israel, protects these Gibeonites because a deal had been struck. And they go on, even though they were no doubt prideful men and a prideful people, they go on to serve God. And much the same as Rahab, who heard about the conquests of Jehovah God, came to place her faith in God, I believe many of these people must have as well. In this, I see the grace of God at work. Amazing way. And I'm reminded of that passage over in Deuteronomy again, that chapter 20, when you approach the city to fight against it, you'll offer it terms of peace. If it agrees to make peace with you and opens to you, then all the people who are found in it shall become your forced labor and serve you. The grace of God. I leave you with two thoughts this morning. If you're here and you've never placed your faith in Jesus Christ, understand this, that he is the one and only Savior. And for you to come out from under the wrath of God, you need to place your faith in Jesus alone. And if you're a follower of Jesus Christ, he calls for us to walk by faith and not by sight. Coming to him, allowing him to lead us in our life. Let's pray together, shall we? Before I ask you to stand for prayer, you may be here this morning and have yet to place your faith in Jesus Christ. I wonder today if God is pressing that upon your heart. If today you might say, Lord, save me. Forgive me of my sin. Placing your faith in Jesus and him alone. And maybe you're here this morning and you'd say, Pastor Kevin, God is speaking to my heart. I've not really sought the will of the Lord on many things. I just live life and it's such an easy thing to do. One day becomes 2 days, becomes a week, becomes a month, becomes years. And we do it our own way. Maybe you're here this morning and you say, Pastor Kevin, pray for me today. God's speaking to my heart about walking by faith and not by sight. Is there anyone you just slip up your hand and say, Pastor, pray for me today? God's tugging on my heart. Amen. Thank you. Maybe you're here this morning and you say, Pastor, pray for me also. God's at work at my heart, leading me to place my faith in Jesus Christ. Is there anyone you'd say, pray for me too, Pastor Kevin? Just slip up your hand. I want to place my faith in Jesus Christ. I want to make that all-important decision. Would you stand with me, please? Our Father in heaven, we do come before you this morning so very thankful. Thankful for the message here in Joshua chapter 9. Thankful, Father, for the lessons learned. Help us, Father, to understand the dynamic of your grace towards us. Help us, Father, today to understand the significance of Jesus Christ. May each one have placed their faith and trust in Jesus alone. And Father, I lift up those this morning who have asked for prayer, desire to walk by faith and not by sight, who want to inquire of the Lord and know, Father, you answer prayer and you direct our paths. May we be a people who are led by you. And may that bring glory and honor to you, I pray. Bless this week ahead, Lord. May we use it wisely. May we live each moment, Lord, in light of the imminent return of our Savior, Jesus Christ. We thank you for all these things now, Lord. I pray it all in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you.